Design number one uses two sets of pinus radiata. The first set forms the front two legs, which are situated underneath the seat. The second set form the back two legs, which support both the seat and the backrest.
After experimenting with various designs, we have settled on a basic one. This design makes use of dovetail and mortise and tenon joints. We are using offcuts from previous projects to minimize waste. Any surface marks will be removed in the finishing process. These two pieces will form the back legs, while these will form the front legs. This set will be divided into four pieces to form the base of the seat. The seat will be woven on later. These three will form crossbars. The larger two will be attached to the sides, and the smaller one will be attached to the front. This piece will be cut in half. Each half will form a backrest. We mark and identify the pieces that will form the legs and seat. We then construct a stencil describing a 1:6 angle, which is used to mark the shape of the dovetail pins.
The next phase is cutting the pieces forming the legs and seat to size. This is done with a tenon saw or a handsaw. Any waste is trimmed off using a coping saw, hacksaw, or sanded off using garnet paper. The dovetail pins are cut using a coping saw or tenon saw. Excess waste is paired off with a chisel. After this process is complete, the pin is laid over the corresponding socket on the leg. The dovetail shape is traced onto it, and the two corresponding pieces are marked with the same letter.
The sides of this socket are cut using a tenon saw. A chisel is hammered down through the wood to create the back of the socket. The rest of the socket is knocked back to this line with the chisel. This process is repeated until the bottom of the socket is reached. This area is pared until the pin fits in snugly. Once these sockets are connected to the pins, the form of the chair starts to become visible. Next, we mark the lengths of the final pins. First are the dovetail pins of the crossbars. We mistakenly notated the pieces forming the seat as crossbars. For want of a better word, we dub the actual crossbars floopies.
The floopies are cut predominantly with coping saws, and their joints are paired using chisels. The backrests were going to be connected by mortise and tenon joints. However, the wood used was too thin to cut into the face. As a result, we settle on a joint that involves a mortise but has a simplified pin. The construction of the chair is cut short as we travel back to the city, but we resume work there.
We mark out the mortises and add symbols to the corresponding pins.
We chisel the sides of the mortise before chiseling out the waste between these sides. We repeat this process until we reach the bottom of the mortise and the pin fits in snugly. We create the sockets for the floopies dovetails the same way we made the crossbars dovetail sockets, by sawing the sides, chiseling down the backside, and chiseling back to this point.
The completion of these sockets marks the end of joint construction. This means we can do a dry assembly of the chair to reveal its final shape. Before assembly, we remove surface marks with an eraser. Any symbols indicating corresponding pieces are moved to locations which will be invisible after assembly.
Naturally, the next step is the assembly. We start with the pieces forming the front surface of the chair. We cover the points of contact between the dovetails and sockets with an even coat of glue, taking care not to coat the exterior surfaces, and connect the joints. We wipe off any excess glue using a damp cloth and allow the assembled front piece to dry. We repeat this process for the pieces forming the back surface, and we perform these steps one final time as we connect the front and back pieces by attaching the side floopies and crossbars.
With the chair assembled, we start to sand the surfaces in the finishing process. We begin by using rough, low-grade garnet paper to level all the joints and surfaces or to remove any marks left from the construction process. We incrementally increase the grade of the paper until we reach grade 600, at which point the wood is sufficiently smooth, taking care to sand in the direction of the wood's grain so as to prevent scratches. This is difficult when leveling joints, as the two connecting pieces of wood often have perpendicular grain directions.
Following sanding, we collect the sawdust and mix it with glue to create a solution similar to wood putty but more realistic, as it's made of the actual wood we're using. We use this solution to fill any gaps in the joints, as well as any other holes in the wood's surface.
With another Milton trip looming, an intensive day of work to finish the chair takes place. A final round of sanding is performed, with the finish to be left unvarnished.
Following this, we calculate the necessary rope for the seat. Two rolls of 3mm rope are purchased. A bowline is used to secure the rope to the crossbars.
We begin by winding the rope horizontally around the side crossbars, spacing the rope evenly in order to preserve rope and prevent entanglement. We also wind the rope tightly to ensure the seat is supportive. Finally, we use another bowline to secure the seat.
It is decided that it is impractical and unnecessary to string rope between the front and back crossbars. Consequently, this is omitted.
We add felt squares to the bottom of the legs to stabilize the chair and soften impacts.
We space the existing ropes evenly on the crossbars into their final position. We secure this position by smearing glue onto the underside of the side crossbars, sealing the points of contact between the rope and the wood. Any excess glue is removed using a damp cloth.
Lastly, we allow the glue to dry. A year after the beginning of the project, the chair is finally finished.
Good.